presenters. So we're going to try to stay on track, and what I want to do first is just bring up Gene Marchand. He's the director of the Wilderness School, and he's going to talk a little bit about the Wilderness School, and then he's going to bring up Mark, who's the president of the Heartland Land Trust, and we'll talk a little bit. Then we're going to introduce Marty. Marty's going to do the slideshow and the CC show for him. Okay, Gene Marchand, your hand.
The Wilderness School is a program totally funded by the Department of Children and Families. And I'd be happy to, talk to folks or give you a tour at some point, but just so you know, our signature program is an expedition based on the Outward Bound model. So we take kids and do 5-day or 20-day expeditions, along with a host of other programming. That's the signature program. This program's been in existence for 42 years. We've been here at this base camp since 1990. Tom can give you the particulars. He was the director here that helped the Wilderness School get established in Heartland at this particular site. So we're a very unique program. Our motto is learn to believe in yourself. And if I had my druthers, I would have every adolescent go through a program like this before they get out of high school, because it really teaches kids. They get to challenge themselves, they learn to trust, they learn the challenges of nature and the beauty of nature. So about half of our kids come from DCF, or they might be DCF kids committed for abuse and neglect. We deal with some juvenile justice kids as well. And then we deal with kids from all over the state, just referred by a school, a counselor, or their family. So we're really proud of this program. The Connecticut Department of Children and Families is the only governmental agency in the country for child welfare and juvenile justice that has a program like this. So we're really proud of this, and we're happy to have our neighbors come out and see the place and get familiar with us, and we'll be here if anybody wants to come back for a visit. So, welcome.
Thank you so much for coming. I'm Mark Giarnik, for those who don't know me. I'm the current president of the Heartland Land Trust. And I've been fortunate to work with that crew for a few years now, and it's a bunch of people. I'd like to thank Gene Marchand and Tom Dyer and the staff at the Wilderness School for hosting us here. They've done a bunch of organization, and they've got a fantastic venue. And we really appreciate the opportunity. I'd also like to thank all the Historical Society people that are here and have been helping organize this publicity. The slideshow has been that you guys have put together, artifact display, and just being here to celebrate with us. We really appreciate it. So thanks so much. The Land Trust and the Historical Society are really both dedicated to conservation in our town, cultural conservation and natural environment, maintaining the rural character here. And so it's really great that we can spend time with you guys. The Land Trust sponsors a variety of speakers over the course of the year, typically up at the school. But we have sort of a special one today. It's our 10th anniversary. It was October of 2006 that we were granted our 501c3, or we were incorporated, and the 501c3 was granted in October 2007. Our primary focus is really to protect watershed land and other environmentally significant properties in the Heartland. And obviously quite a bit of the town is protected already. A big part of what we try to do is just promote public education, the appreciation of the wilderness and the wildlife around here. So, try to get speakers and things for of interest to the town. We're interested in, trying to be a resource to landowners here. So there's a variety of people we've worked with over time, and if there's anybody who needs our support, we'd be happy to help. We own and protect the Bassett Hill Reserve in West Heartland, which is next to the Audubon Society sanctuary there. And we're currently doing a biological survey of that, which has been very interesting and fun. In 2015, we worked with a local landowner in a town here in Reese, Sussex, in the Department of Environmental, Energy and Environmental Protection. There was a 74-acre hole in the middle of a Tunsa State Forest, and we were able to plug that hole, which is great, and it's a nice wildlife corridor coming down from Massachusetts and flowing through here, so that's a good protective canyon. For the past 10 years, we've been sponsoring our speaker series for the general public. Many of you have come to those, as recognized in the audience here. And, you know, with nature experts and, you know, we can answer questions there typically. I just want to share that the next one of those is November 28th up at the Arkham School. And the it's going to be a fellow named Sean Grace from the Audubon. He's the director of the Audubon Society in Sharon. He's going to be talking about forests, forests for the birds, at 7:30. We've been supporting the Heartland School, Sandman Schools Project for the last 4 years. And hopefully all of you receive our annual newsletter, which is called Preservationists, which we send everybody in Heartland. So if you don't get it, you can contact us through our website and we'll make a point to get it to you. But in any case, just to wrap up there, you know, it's been 10 years. It's a small group of volunteers, but we feel like we've come a long way, and we're looking forward to the next 10 years. There is a table we have here with some calendars and cards and things featuring Heartland Wildlife photographers. And so if you're interested in that, so you can look those up for it. I was going to promote our guest speaker's book on the CCC, but I'm told that you haven't gotten them quite yet, but they are coming out soon. And when they do come out, our land trust here has already ordered one of those, and we'll donate it to the town library so you can find it there. But hopefully, you can order your own. So the agenda today: our guest speaker is Marty Podskotch, who will begin here shortly at 2 o'clock. We've got a break. There'll be some refreshments. We have some cake. And the Historical Society has a meeting in the administration building over here, which I understand has been refurbished recently and looks beautiful. And I'm looking forward to checking it out, maybe peeking in before you guys get started. I believe you're planning on starting at 2:30. And then, but you guys can organize that however you want to work it out. And then at 3 o'clock, Tom Dyer, who spoke open here, is going to lead us on a walk through the woods and visit the remains of the CCC camp.
Correct.
I guess, right? So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Marty Podskotch, and thank you so much for coming. He's an author, historian, and really an expert on the Civilian Conservation Corps. His focus here is going to be in Connecticut CCC camps, and our own camp here, which was Camp Robinson, I believe. And the work that they did in Heartland. So you do have a new book coming out, and you can tell us a little more about it, but it's still coming out. And so without further discussion, I'd like to turn it over to Martin.
My father grew up in Hortsberry.
Really?
Yeah.
Anybody else? Okay.
I went to King's College and I studied history and government, so I love history. And got a job teaching in New Jersey. And anybody from New Jersey? Where?
Westfield,
beautiful, Mike. Yeah.
That's miserable.
Westfield, now my uncle lived there. I taught in a little place called Old Bridge, New Jersey, near New Brunswick. And I taught fourth grade, then seventh and eighth grade history. Then I got a master's in reading at Newark State. And then I met my wife, whose father originally was from Middlefield, Connecticut. Anybody know where Middlefield is? Okay, and then, they're farmers. And then he had gone to different places in New York State, and then he wound up in a little town called Oneeko, Connecticut, near the Rhode Island border. You know where that is. And that's where we married in Canterbury. And then we went to a little town called Delhi in Catskills, near Oneonta, between Albany and Binghamton. So it's in the western part, and had an old farmhouse, raised our three kids along the Delaware, west branch of the Delaware, big old farmhouse, big barn. So it was a nice place to live. And then when I retired, my daughter was down here, so we moved to Colchester for 5 years. So we got a place in East Hampton on where I'm at today. And then, and what else? Oh, so I'm at the Historical Society there, because it's Bell Town, but it used to be really famous for bells. And now it's famous for, believe it or not, witch hazel. It was 99% of the world's supply of witch hazel. Believe it or not, if you drive through there, you'll see this right near the lake. And so I was with the Land Trust in Colchester, so I used to do monthly walks in Colchester. We had Salmon River, and I do monthly walks now in East Hampton. So I'm also at the Energy Task Force, or trying to get people to get into green power, because I hate oil companies. I hate the pollution. So hopefully we'll get to be more solar, wind power, and there's so many other ways of getting our electricity instead of, but it takes time. My grandfathers are coal miners. And thank God, we're getting rid of that, no matter unless they're able to get it better. So that's a little bit about myself, but I've done a bunch of books. I went to Fire Tower on Hunter Mountain. Anybody climb Hunter Mountain? And my first book I was a reading teacher, and I tried to get kids interested in reading by having authors come to my school. I had Eric Carle stay at my house, the Hungry Caterpillar, came for free, made breakfast for Eric, and my daughter sat on his lap and he read the Hungry Caterpillar. I had, from Kent School for Boys, I had Bill Real Sounder, Armstrong. Bill Armstrong, what a fantastic guy, too. I had Howard Koch, who did Casablanca, wrote the movie, Ann Martin, the babysitter books. So for 25 years, I had all these authors come for free, and a lot of them stayed at my house. So then I told the publisher about, I went to a Fire Tower, and thought, oh boy, there, oh, I need somebody. What's your first name? Jacob, would you be, you're a computer literate, aren't you? Would you sit here? And when I tell you, you just push this button forward and this one back, Jacob. What grade are you in? What grade are you in, Jacob? Fourth grade, that was my first year. So you can push that. That was the tower that I climbed. Believe it or not, I'm afraid of heights. So I haven't gotten to all these towers, but this one, I felt so great when my first book was done about the Catskills. Anybody go to the Catskills? Yeah. Everybody says the Catskill Game Farm, right?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Hunter Mountain?
That's New York.
Yeah, that's New York. I know, there was, I just found out from Jerry, and we are very lucky, I don't know if you people know this, but we have a CCC boy in our midst. Joe, would you stand up, please? Joe? So I have to wait till Tuesday for the book to be delivered. Not like this. And 3,000 books are waiting someplace. And it's 11,000 pounds. So I'm trying, I woke up today, I was trying to figure, where am I going to store all of those books? Besides the 7 other books that I have in storage in my garage. But I got that one done. And next, Jason. So here is a little old Delhi, where I taught school. And then I decided I was going to go to the Adirondacks. So I started doing that one. And believe it or not, my southern, there were 57 towers there. So I did a my books got a little thicker, too. I got better at research. And I just would give talks throughout the whole Adirondack. So I got to know it pretty well. And next. Is that forward? Okay, next. So I went up there and traveled 6 million acres. Now, the Wilderness School, they have a trip coming up to Blue Mountain, I think you're going to, and maybe they'll even go to a fire tower. And if anybody is interested, I'm looking, and now I'm the head, I'm the director of a worldwide organization called the Forest Fire Lookout Association. And I'm looking for members too. So if anybody would like to join this is fire towers all over, even in Australia. It's $15 a year, and there is a brochure. Okay, next. So I traveled all these towns, next. And so I got that one. So that sold out 3 printings. I've got to do 9,000 books. So I've got to get working on that one. That's the big one, because people just love to go to the southern part. They don't go to the northern Adirondacks. It's a little bit further. Next. So this is a fire tower on St. Regis Mountain and the Saranac Lake down there. And up there, they have different classifications of land. One of them is a canoe area, one is wilderness. So anything now after 71 that's in a wilderness area, anything made by man's got to come down. So it turns out now that I got the people psyched up to save their tower, showing them historically how they're important. You people had one 7 miles up the road and it's gone. Okay? I've got a track to try to find out all the rest of the towers. I know Mohawk Mountain still has their tower. Okay? And I think there's one towards Rhode Island border there too. But this one, so it's been saved. Governor Cuomo, the son of the governor in the 90s, he set aside 1 acre around the base. It's not wilderness, it's historic. So, and local people around there have restored it. So that's what's been happening in the Adirondacks. Crazy thing is that your father is working on books on the fire towers, but they helped save our forest, and they're still out west. Are you out west?
Yep.
From Washington?
Portland, Oregon.
Tell them about the fire towers there.
They're still active. People still use them. Wildland firefighters get stationed there, and they use it to look for smoke and scout wildfires.
And you could even rent these fire towers,
yeah,
some of them, and stay in them. 12 by 12 These cabs are 7 by 7 No, there's beds, cooking.
Yeah.
Have you ever been in any of them?
Yeah, it's cool. You can rent them out. They're really cheap. Sometimes they're free. You just have to schedule it, and you backpack out to them, and they're really remote.
Yeah. You ready to go?
Yeah.
Yes. We're getting next. So I got to this thing, I've got 3 books done, and I can't get into all the towers. The only way I get up there is sometimes I'll hold somebody's hand or shoulder, and I close my eyes, and then I open my eyes, and wow, what a view, you know, it's fantastic. And then the wind is blowing, and then I feel, I just want to get down. So, a lady up there, her father was up there by Lake Placid in charge of all the forests. She had these photos of CCCs. And I said, wow, I'll make copies. So I went from fire towers to the men. These were the men and women up there that saved the mountains from fires. Now the men who work building up our state and our national forest. And it's been a great adventure traveling to all these different people. I've interviewed hundreds of guys like Joe here and gotten their stories, and they're just unbelievable. My latest book is 544 pages, just on Connecticut CCCs. And a lot of these guys have passed away, but I was able to find something at UConn. They belong to a special service, a library in Chicago that has the largest collection of newspapers in the world, and they have the largest collection of CCC camp newspapers. So this and a few more are just of your camp. Every month they came out with a camp newspaper, and they tell what they were doing, the jokes, the illustrations, etc. So I'll pass these around to you, then I've got to arrange them, so just be careful. And for the Historic Society, huh?
Did you go to Camp Robinson? Or
Camp Robinson.
Okay.
No, just
awesome.
Camp Robinson. So you will find them very, interesting. Some of the stuff, I have to keep looking to find out the good stuff. And they'll probably find to his uncle, Thompson, who was the captain. So it turns out that the government realized that most of the boys in the camp in 33, when it started, they were mostly just had eighth grade education. They dropped out of school. Why, Joe? Why did a lot of the boys drop out of school?
Why did they drop out of school? Why did they drop out of school?
Why did a lot of boys during the...
Why did a lot of the boys drop out of school?
Why did a lot of boys drop out of school?
Yeah.
Well, one reason is because at that time it was hard times. And a lot of them had to leave their schooling and to get to find a job. And like myself, I had to leave school too. And I became a bin boy, made a few dollars every night, but that's it.
Yeah, they had to help the family. Some of these boys, 6, 8, 10, 12 in a family, 8th grade, you got to help the family. Sometimes the parents might have been divorced, not too many, but there were. Or sometimes the father was an alcoholic, he left the family. I mean, this one guy, he lived in the house that Joyce Kilmer lived in, I don't think, I think that I shall never see.
Yeah.
Remember, we had to memorize that? But they, his father had this big business in Westchester County, and so he had to sell his house. He came to Connecticut, and they had four or five kids in the family. The father left the mother alone with four kids. So this boy, he said, Marty, I have to quit school. So he quit school. He came to, I think it was Housatonic Meadows, 6 months. They would sign up for 6 months and then go out. Then he went out to Colorado, Grand Junction. Stayed there for 6 months, another 6 months. Even would hitchhike on the trains and go to Mexico. Another time, he and his buddy, after 6 months were up, went to California, riding the boxcars. Then he went to take a test to get his GED. And the lady says, you're too smart. You're going right to college. He wound up engineering at University of New Haven. Then he wound up the head of the chairman of the department. All this from starting off in the CCC. So I'll just pass these out. And you'll probably have some fun. I could stay here all day and just talk about the CCC. To the back row, cheap seats.
Yep, yep.
That you've got. You're in the back row.
Uh-oh.
You're in the back row. You can see the illustrations they made, and it's just, oh, it's just so fantastic. You know, I had one guy in the speculator. He said his father did the illustrating. Yeah, the town speculator had a CCC camp. Okay, where did we leave off? Okay, next. I'm skipping around. So the Depression, okay? My parents grew up in the Depression. My mother, father died in the, working in the coal mines, and she was just 8 years old. There were 8 girls and 1 boy. That mother, my mother's side came from Lithuania. And my father's side came from Slovakia. So they had to take all the terrible jobs. You know, the immigrants coming into the United States, the Italians, the Polish, etc. And it wasn't through education. And then you see the poor Mexicans, the Puerto Ricans, all these other ethnic groups coming to the United States. They have those, they have the rough jobs. And it's not until they or their children get that education that they're able to come up. Just like I was lucky that, you know, I was able to go to college. So it was very tough during these years. Roosevelt, okay, next, Jacob. You get an idea of the poverty, next. Roosevelt was elected, and he said, I propose to create civilian conservation corps to be used in simple work. More important, however, than the material gains will be the moral and spiritual value of such work. Roosevelt, who loved trees, and I don't know if you ever listened to On Point on NPR. You listened last week, this guy from Germany, all about trees. Anybody listen to that? If you have, look at the podcast for the past. That is so good about this guy, about how these trees, look out there, they're able to send messages, electronic messages to the roots, and even giving out odors to be able to talk to each other. And, but this book, I just finally got it from Amazon. It's really great. Just, I forgot, it's a German guy, but it's all about trees. And so he planted thousands of trees at his estate there along the Hudson River. And when he became president, he saw our forests here in Connecticut in the east were devastated. Fires, cutting down trees, the charcoal. How many of you have seen those charcoal circles? Okay? Unbelievable. There was just so much cutting down of the trees, but there was no such thing as reforesting them. What was the problem of conservation in the Midwest? The Dust Bowl, okay? So I just read a book this summer about CCC camps in the Midwest, how they worked with the farmers to show them the proper way of farming. A lot of the boys from Connecticut went to Colorado, and there were camps there, and they worked a lot with the ranchers, fencing, what else they do, with the sheep, etc. A lot of work there. And then out towards Washington, Oregon, our national parks. You go out to national parks, how many have seen the work of the CCC? You can see the Adirondack-style buildings, okay? Yosemite, where else have you seen work? CCC.
Oh, I don't know.
How about Virginia? Jerry?
Valley of Fire, State Park, Nevada.
The Valley of Fire?
State Park, Nevada. They did Auto Stone.
Blue Ridge Parkway.
The Blue Ridge Parkway, Virginia, okay? Yes?
Mount Hood.
There's so much. And the thing about the CCC, they did it 9 years. Billions of trees. And a lady remarked, why don't they have that today? Well, they do have some form, Montana, as the Montana Civilian Conservation Corps. California, does anything in Oregon or Washington have?
I don't know.
Okay. But there are a few states that do it. Governor Rell, remember Jody Rell? Her father was in the CCC. She said, Marty, if I only asked my father where he was, what he did, I never asked him. And I know I wound up knowing more about these guys than the children because I asked them the questions and I've gotten these stories down. Many of the guys that I've, most of the guys that I've interviewed have passed away, but their stories have preserved. And we've got Manchester?
Bob Manchester.
Bob, tell them about your father.
My father, his father died when he was 7 years old in 1921. And my grandmother was with four kids by herself.
21?
Yeah, and then she married a fellow that didn't turn out too well. He did it in 7. By herself. Previously, yeah. Anyway, he went into 33 and served to 35 in Ballantyre and Niagara. And you run out of time, buddy. He died when I was still younger. There were so many things I would have liked to have asked that I never did. But I mean, he was the kind of guy, you know, trials and depression, that could do pretty much anything. He was an eighth grade dropout, probably the smartest guy I ever knew. And you know, he knew about music and he knew about your progressions and everything, but I just wish that I could have learned more from him.
Thank you. Yes?
My father won the CCCs and got shipped down to Long Island, and every off hour they caught him fishing in Long Island Sound. And so finally his commander said to him, Fred, you like to fish a lot? He says, yeah. He says, I love to fish. So I got a picture of him. They sent him to Flagstaff, Maine, and I got a picture of him at the camp in Flagstaff, Maine. And they fed deer in the wintertime and they planted trees in the off the rest of the year. And it was quite a story. He absolutely loved it up there. And got to feed so many deer that he gave up deer hunting and never shot another deer. He said the deer used to just follow the wagons when they would drop off the hay in the wintertime. And he said, from then on, he never shot another deer.
It's just, you know, I'm ready to go to do Rhode Island. I went to the 6 camps there. Massachusetts is also such an enticing place to go. The Berkshires have a lot of CCC camps. Bear something mountain? Okay. There's a guy in Stafford Springs who worked there. He's still alive, 97, in Stafford Springs. Bear Town Mountain. That's it. Yeah. So I'm going to be 73 next month, and I don't know how long I'm going to be able to keep driving, especially Tuesday or Thursday. I did another book, which is about trying to get people to visit all the 102 towns of the Adirondacks. So this is Vermont has what they call the 251 Club, and people have been doing this since 1954, traveling all over Vermont. 61 years, they love it. In fact, there's 8,000 members. So I said to the supervisors, why don't we do a book about the Adirondacks traveling to all 102 towns? So it's a guidebook, tells you where the town is, what is the little history, and what to do there when you get there, and a place to get it stamped or signed by somebody. So it's a passport book and a checkoff list. So guess what my next book is going to be? Connecticut, 169. Now, what I did is I had somebody from each town write about their town. So I need somebody from each department. And that would be my first town. East Park, what did I say? No East.
There's an east and a west side, but we should call us Heartland.
It's still just one town?
Yes.
Good. Now, if there's somebody in the audience who would like to do that, all you have to do is 525 words, where it's at, etc., and you'll be an author. So see me after, and I'll even give you a book just to go with. And I told you I was, I went around, I had authors. I had this comic book illustrator from World War II, Sam Glansman, and he said, Marty, I'm almost 9 or 8 years old, not much time to live. How would you like to write a book together, do something together? So I said, I travel all over the Adirondacks. Well, let's do a book like Believe It or Not. So every week for 5 years, I wrote just a little caption, set of pictures, and every week Sam would illustrate a story about the Adirondacks. Because I was a remedial reading teacher. Well, you're missing everything. We're behind. So this was, I love doing this, and it's still in the newspapers in the Adirondacks, going on its third reprinting. So, next. So he signed it, and he proposed it to Congress. And 3 days later, 4 days later, it passed. Just like our I was in Washington and just this week, and it's such a beautiful city. And this, just on TV last night, they said they only work for 107 days. They're on vacation the rest of the time. They don't speak to each other. They don't do anything. Okay, so there. So he said, I want to have 250,000 boys by July 1st. He chose the Army. The Army could quickly get to work on it. And next, there's the Army. They were in charge. They built these buildings. Next, they were going to give the discipline. He chose the Department of Labor. They knew the poor families in Heartland. Okay? So since it's a small town, maybe one boy might be able to get to go. Whereas Hartford, bigger population, they got more boys could sign up. You would sign up for 6 months. You were paid $1 a day. At the end of the month, you had $30. 25 went straight home to the parents. You had $5 to spend. Now, you have one of the matchbook covers?
Mm-hmm.
Could you show it? Or?
Yeah.
What's your first name again?
Brett.
Brett. Brett is an aficionado of CCC stuff. And they would have a canteen where they sold soda, tobacco, cigarettes, candy, shaving stuff, etc.
Pass that around?
You have to be very careful.
Yeah, it's in plastic. It's
good. Okay. But they even have matchbook covers. And some of the stuff you can get on eBay. Some of the other stuff you might get. Next. The Army gave physicals. Most of the boys passed to see how thin they were. They're lucky if they had one meal a day. Next. The boys were shipped out. You didn't have a choice. I want to go to Hartland. No, I want to go to Voluntown. Sometimes you were shipped out west. You were on a train 5 days until you got to Oregon. Okay? And the Army did the transporting. Next. Then you've got clothing. These boys that had holes in their shoes, okay, not even a coat, okay, they were given socks, shoes, raincoats, everything for that 6 month period of time. When I was in the Putnam Library in 2008, I decided to do a book on Connecticut CCCs. So I was in Putnam, I gave 60 talks in 1 year. I'm a retired teacher, 60 talks. And this is where people would be in the audience, like Joe. Oh, I'm in the CCC. I met Tom at the Cromwell Library, okay? This guy said, I bought this house, and they had a CCC jacket, which they use, you know, maybe when they're going home or in parades, they would hitchhike, and so if they had this on, they could easily get a ride those days. So they're nice wool, okay? And what else do I have to give you? Oh, show you some more things. Then they might be selling things like, too, a lady gave me this, her father had it at this a CCC camp. I forget which one it was in town. And then you might want to get one of these for your sweetheart. And for your mother. So they have different things. And one person, I went, oh, in fact, they were at this camp. Where did I leave it? Anybody see a little box? Okay. One lady said, Marty, my husband saved up money and he bought a ring for me, okay? She says, nobody wants it. Do you want it? So there, if you can see it, that has a tree and also the surveyor's, what's my call it called? Trenchant. Who hasn't seen anything for a while? Okay, so I take it around. Also, you get a chance on that, see the box over there on the table? A lady gave me her father's truck he made at the cobalt camp by Portland. 1933, you'll see it carved in there. Okay, next. So they were living at first in tents, and then they were in barracks. Next. He had a commanding officer, like his father, or his uncle. They hired a person just to be the education advisor, to teach the guys skills during in the evening they wanted. Reading, writing, photography, whatever. And he would have, say like this, what's your name? Paul. Oh, Paul, you look familiar. Your dad was in the CCC too. Tell him about your dad.
My dad was like a lot of the others. He got out of school in seventh grade to go to work for the family because there was 11 kids in the family. And he worked, but then there was no work. So he wound up collecting a little bit of welfare, and then the welfare office sent him up to camp.
What camp was your dad?
He was up in Cornwall.
Okay.
Plus.
Housatonic Meadows.
Right.
Housatonic Meadows. Very good. You never know what you'll find in the audience here. Wow, I forgot, where did we meet?
At the CCC reunion.
At a CCC reunion?
No.
Or was it with my? Yeah. Okay, we only have 10 minutes. Okay, so, St. Paul, they would have 5 barracks. The 200 boys in the camp, how many in each barracks? Who said 40? All right, are you a math teacher? Very good. Now, could you just imagine 40 boys, 18 to 25, in a barracks building? How many were high school teachers, junior high teachers? I was in middle school, okay. Now, Paul, we're gonna make you the leader. Instead of $30, you're gonna get $45. And you have got to keep them in line. And what's your name?
Chip.
Chip? Chip. You're going to be his assistant, and you're going to get $36 a month.
Why not 40?
You're the assistant. Maybe you'll work your way up.
All right.
Okay, next. They had an infirmary. Sometimes they had their own doctor, an army doctor there, or a doctor from town would be called in for special care. One boy, he didn't have to plant trees or cut trees down. He was in charge of the infirmary, okay? And he would be there, get food for them, you know, probably all the cuts, etc. Probably a lot of the guys faking it too, you know. I'm sick, you know. Jacob, do you ever tell your dad or mom, I don't feel good today, go to school? Have you done that? Yes! Jacob has done that. He's honest.
Look at that poor guy.
Leave the fifth, Jackie. Okay, next.
Too honest.
And so they went from tents to buildings. Next. Get up at 6. Look at everything is nice and orderly. Raising the flag. Then you were assigned to the jobs. Next. They would hire local experienced men. What's your name?
Ted.
Ted. You worked in the woods. You're going to be working with maybe 10, 12 boys, pruning the trees, you know, taking all the dead wood out, etc. like that. Okay, and then they could use it for the charcoal, making charcoal. Okay? You would get a job. Another guy around here might get a job. And must anybody's father work as a what they call LEM, local experienced men, okay? So they'd have the conservation department, forest rangers working here, foresters plus LEMs doing like at your wilderness camp. Next, lunchtime, they would take a break, a 8-hour day. Next, dinner bell at 5, next. They'd also have these books. So a lot of times when they came to camp, they didn't have any money, they would give them a book of a dollar's worth of stamps and take it out of their $5. They had bands, and it was integrated. Down in Pennsylvania, New York, you had black camps, white camps, and veterans camps. Guys that were in World War I or the Spanish-American War. Next. They had recreation, they had sports, next. KP duty if you got in trouble, next. Take you into town to a religious service, or a chaplain might come to the camp, next. They got training, next. Education classes, photography, typing, next. Some boys were chosen to be truck drivers. Maybe they were farmers, farm boys, so they got to do it. Or even some of those kids from Brooklyn. Where's the girl from Brooklyn? She's not here. Okay, so they had to teach them. Next. In the camp, look at it. Army and conservation trucks. because you had to transport these boys to doing jobs around here in the Tunxus Forest. Next, they had their own camp newspapers, which you read, or the National Weekly, it's called Happy Days. News all over the United States. Now, how many states were there in 1933?
Put this on.
48.
Keeps you warm.
So not only in the 48 states, but where else were there CCC camps?
Alaska.
Hawaii. Puerto Rico. What? Virgin Islands. Name the three Virgin Islands. St. Croix, St. Thomas, and St. John. And I was there, and I went to the museum, and they did road work, park work, and planting mahogany trees. And how many have been to Puerto Rico? El Yunque. You know that road, Serpentine Road, and the buildings? CCCs. Ideas. There's so much they do. Next. Okay, so at first, it started Emergency Conservation Work Act. That's what it was called at first, not the CCCs. Listed, supply dock was in Fort Wright, Fisher's Island, okay, New York. So at first there were 14 camps. By December there were 15. Next. So these were all the locations of the camp, and yours was the most northerly, okay? Some were started in 33, your camp kept going, okay? Voluntown was another one that was there for 9 years. Some were just for 2 years, okay, next. So here's an idea of all the camps and when they started. Next, these will all be in the book. Then it was moved from Fisher's Island to New London, and that's where the supplies, all the food, a lot of the food, the trucks were repaired there, and they had a camp there. Next. Okay, here's your Camp Robinson. This is the Wilderness School. It was built by the CCCs. Okay, there's the entranceway, and it was on the other side of the road where the State Highway Department is. So most of the camp has all been bulldozed over. Okay, next, Camp Robinson. Who was Lucius Robinson? Noted Connecticut lawyer, environmentalist. He was a Yale graduate, president of the Bar Association, director of several insurance companies in Hartford. He was also on the Connecticut Forest and Park Commission from 13 to 36, chairman, 17 to 37. During this time, 12,000 acres of parks, 80,000 acres of state forests were added. He was also president of the Hartford City Parks. Governor Wilbur Cross asked for his expertise, creation of the Merritt Parkway. So that's who this guy was. Next. And this is from a yearbook, and believe it or not, I forgot. For 1937, the 48 states had a yearbook. And me of all persons, I had to bring the wrong one, the New York State one. And every state had a yearbook, okay? So it has the camp and what they were doing, a little bit. So I bought one up there in Lake Placid like this for $167. I needed it. Then I wound up with three more copies. Next, look at here. Here's the tents. The boys lived in these tents here. And one thing sometimes, if you ever go to some of these places, maybe down to bar camps, that you might even see the stones along the way. Okay? Next. Here's a view of the camp. So probably maybe eight boys in a tent. Next. They had a water tower. Next. And here's an aerial view, okay?
Is that Camp Robinson?
This is Camp Robinson. So this must be Route 22.
20,
sorry. Okay, and here's the farm. Is the farmhouse still there or gone? Gone, okay. So this probably was all that farm. Did anybody know the historian here? Anybody know whose farm this was?
Oh, we believe it was the Emmons family too, originally, if you'll be here.
Okay, the building was there. Next. See, then they started building some, I'll move out of the way. Next. And there's that, probably looking from the back towards Route 20. Okay, the water tower, and then the road was there. Can you see the ladders there? You know why they were on the roof? Fire, okay? What they were using is, I guess wood, but mostly the Army liked coal, believe it or not. You know, I used wood for about 20 years, and also coal, and, but you know, chimney fires. Any firemen, fire ladies here? The chimney fire problem. Next. And some of the trucks at camp. Next. And here shows the construction of the building. Next. And I haven't seen this, but the ski lodge. Still there?
Yeah.
Okay, ski area. No more skiing though, right?
No skiing. No.
Next. Lean-to. Is it still there?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The original one?
Yeah.
It's one of the historic places.
Really?
Yeah.
Now, what trail would that be on?
It's up and down the rock.
It's a truck trail across the street.
Okay, next. Now, here's a picture, okay? It was with the Tunksis State Forest and was on the Farmington River, okay? They used the cribbing for the stones and they built the bridge, but I've also seen this bridge. I don't know if that was close by to here, but there's a guy that I interviewed in Barkhamsted. His father was the forester. I forgot his name, I don't have my book here. Next.
Was it Roberts?
This guy here. His,
is that bridge on Farmington River?
Farmington River. Yeah.
Is that down river and it was then replaced with a stone bridge and that one's
yes.
Down?
Yes, yeah.
That's the one that's...
Right, all you have is a stone...
The stone bridge.
But I was at this guy's house. God, I don't remember his name. The lower part there, Barkhamsted, and he shared this photo of his dad. Next, working in the woods up. And here's some more guys working in a gravel pit because you need it for the road, shoveling snow. Next. And here is, I don't know if you have any of the big long.
I have one 1935.
Do you?
But it's not in the it's in the slideshow. Yeah.
Do you? I have this one.
Oh.
I got it at Bolton Landing Antique Shop on Lake George. I traded an old boat motor for this one. They would sell them to the boys like for $2, okay? And you can see the things. This was Houston Meadows. Is that the one your dad was? Oh, your dad was that one. Maybe you can see your dad in this one. Okay, I'll pass that out. Okay, this was a 1935 photo. Next. Now, in the building, this guy, Dr. Raymond Keenholz, okay? He was a professor at UConn, forestry. And anybody ever heard of this guy?
I know him personally, I know his daughter. I talked to our Ray on the telephone this week.
I get the first time.